Good afternoon. I think I'm a little bit loud. Just going to turn me down. A warm welcome to you, John, and to the family and friends of Margaret Hart. We've come to celebrate her life, a wonderful life, and give thanks for her life. We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. We look not to the things that are seen, but to things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Today we come together to remember before God our sister Margaret, to give thanks for her life, and to comfort one another. An opening prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you because you made us in your own image and gave us gifts in body, mind, and spirit. We thank you now for Margaret and what she meant to each of us. As we honour her memory, make us more aware that you are the one from whom comes every perfect gift, including the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen. Come to our next hymn. Jesus, only Jesus. I think you can see it on the PowerPoint and in your orders of service. Please stand.
All right.
please be seated. I'm now going to invite John and Kate to come forward to give their tribute.
Since Mum passed away, I've been thinking of some short words and phrases to sum up my memories of her. The first of these would be happiness. We undoubtedly had a very happy childhood, but of course you don't appreciate it at the time. You just take it for granted, you don't know anything else. It's only later on in life you realise that it's a privilege denied to many. My childhood memories are of fun, laughter, birthday parties, Christmases and holidays. I have to say though that I was a pretty horrible teenager. Didn't do a great deal of work, if any, at school. And unfortunately, Mom and Dad had to endure many embarrassing parents' evenings. But there was little in the way of punishment or retribution, just encouragement. Even worse, miraculously, I managed to get enough qualification together to get into Birmingham University. But I left after 3 months. Mom simply couldn't understand it. Understandably so, because she'd wanted to go to university, but wasn't able to because of family circumstances at the time. But again, there was little in the way of condemnation, or not too much. Next would be holidays. Again, there's vivid childhood memories of happy holidays, first in Mum and Dad's tent, then the caravan, as well as Nan and Grandad's caravan in Mid Wales. But by far the most memorable, though, would be our 3 holidays abroad. If you think about it, this would be at the end of the 60s and the beginning of the 70s, when people like us simply didn't go abroad. I remember vividly that I was the only person in my class at school that had been abroad on holiday at that time. And out of those 3, by far the best was when 8 of us went to France and Italy for three weeks in what would now be called a people carrier. And because the holiday was done on a budget, we didn't go out for many meals, which Mum was cooking breakfast, lunch, Annie. It's a private joke with our granddaughter. An evening meal for 8 people in a tent with the most basic camping equipment. But of course, Mum being Mum, it was fantastic. And Kay uses some of those recipes to this day. In fact, we had one last night. I'm sure it can't have been that much of a holiday for Mum, but it's just one example of Mum putting her own interests to one side so that everybody else could have a fantastic time. Which brings me next on to hospitality, which no doubt will resonate with many of you. My childhood memory, again, is of family events, Christmases, where Mum would do the cooking, as well as many times providing Sunday lunch for the visiting speaker at church or having a missionary to stay with us. And as I've just said, many of you will have experienced Mum's wonderful hospitality, but you might not know how Mum too came to be such a brilliant cook. Well, I can explain. Because let's face it, English cuisine in the 1970s wasn't particularly brilliant, to say the least. But Mum, being Mum, decided to do something about it. She booked herself onto a cordon bleu cookery course. And of course, being a cookery course, Mum brought home the dishes she prepared, which we got to try. Mind you, it wasn't always cordon bleu cookery. I do remember having to eat pig's trotters and pig's hearts as well. And woe betide you if you didn't eat it all up. No doubt at all, again, as many of you will have experienced, that Mum was a hard worker. At any church function, you'd see Mum working away, helping with the food, clearing up, making sure everything went smoothly. Mum and Dad retired to Wales in 1990, very shortly after Carissa, our youngest daughter, was born, our only daughter. I was concerned that Mum and Dad would lose the fantastic relationship they had with the children. But I needn't worry, because from a very early age, Mum and Dad would have the children to stay with them. I won't say much about this, because you'll hear more from them later on in a bit. But just to say that, as anyone who's looked after young children will know, it's very hard work. So this is yet another example of mom putting her own interests to one side so that our children could have great adventures, and we had the added bonus of a few days on our own. Then another great legacy that mom left us all was a happy marriage. Mom and dad knew each other for over 70 years and were married for 67, quite an achievement. I already mentioned mom and dad moved to Wales in 1990, but I'm so glad they came back to Birmingham 4 years ago. It's great to spend quality time with mom. And it was quite obvious that mom and dad's relationship was as strong as ever. And it was so touching to see mom in her 90s still kissing dad, sitting on his lap, teasing him and beating him at Scrabble, which she always did. What an example to her children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren. My final thought about mom is about her faith. When I was growing up, my dad ran the Sunday school and then became the minister of the church we went to, and he's still preaching to this day. So I was used and am used to seeing him at the front of the church, but mom never was. She lived out her faith in what is to me the most important place where nobody else is watching, the home. And to me, the best example of this was my nan, who had a stroke in the 1970s, which left her paralysed on one side and unable to speak. As you can imagine, this caused her enormous frustration, but mom offered her exemplary care for about 15 years, again putting on hold her own plans to retire to work to Wales, and another example of mom putting someone else's interests above her own. Before I finish, I'd like to offer my heartfelt thanks to Reverend Paul Turrett for today's service, and particularly for his care and concern for mom since she moved to this church. And I'd also like to thank Paul for coming to the hospital as soon as he heard the news about mom and for giving her a final blessing. Even though mom passed him away peacefully, as you can imagine, the day itself was still very traumatic. But the short service he performed was incredibly moving and turned something horrible into something really beautiful. It's not really possible to adequately thank Paul or to say how much this meant to Dad and me. In conclusion, Mom, thanks for everything, for a wonderful childhood, your love and concern for us as a family since we got married. I'm very proud to be your son. Mom believed she was going to a better place, and I believe that as well. And I believe we're going to meet again. So I'm very happy to say it's both adieu and au revoir.
Whenever we saw Mom or we went into their flat, her first words were always, "Hi there," and I can remember her saying it. She just always said it exactly the same. It was unique, it was an uplifting tone, and it was always very welcoming. I've always been so very grateful that Mom was such an amazing, godly mother-in-law who gave me such a wonderful husband, and I think maybe Dad had something to do with it. If I had to describe her in a few words, it would be kind-hearted, resilient, determined, and a great woman of faith. Often when we met and it was time to leave, this petite woman would offer up powerful, earnest prayers from the heart for all the family, and her faith and trust in God never wavered. In my daily readings recently, the notes accompanying the reading talked about grief, and it was just soon after Mom had passed away. And I thought the comments were so fitting when they said, "God stays close to us even in death. When someone we love passes away, we may become angry and feel abandoned, but his children are precious to him, and our Heavenly Father carefully chooses the time that they are called into his presence." And we really praise God that Mom slipped away at home, when we know in this current climate it could have been so very different, without pain. And we know that she's now in the loving arms of our Heavenly Father. And I can just imagine, as she entered his presence, her saying, "Hi there." Just imagine it. I thank God for a godly example. And she may never know that she taught me so much. As John has said, and you'll probably hear time and time again, she was so hospitable. She amazed me at how her door was always open to anyone at any time. I, on the other hand, have to know the finer detail, to plan and organise to the nth degree, be totally prepared for every eventuality, and we still have problems. But she probably never knew that her willingness to open her door, change her plans, offer support, regardless of the inconvenience to herself, taught me to try and take a pause and a step back and do the same if ever a similar situation presented itself to me. I'm afraid John will verify I don't always manage it. Mum had a lot of health issues to cope with over latter years, and understandably, sometimes in the privacy of home, she would get a little upset, but she never let it show outside, and it always amazed me how it never stopped her wanting to live life to the full. She would go to church, walk around Shustoke, try and carry on as if everything was fine, despite some of her limitations. I think Mum greatly underestimated the influence that she had on other people. And so to finish, it's only fitting to mention some of the lovely words and thoughts that people put in their cards, because she obviously did influence so many people greatly. They said it was an honour to have known her. Her kindness shone out. Her practicality and helpful advice was always so welcome. She was sensitive, an encourager, always had enthusiasm and care for others. Margaret was outward looking and always thinking of others. And there is a constant theme here, isn't there, of her always looking out for others. Margaret was a very special lady, somebody put, and she was indeed a very special lady who I was privileged to have as my mother-in-law. And the final comment that I'll read was that someone said, Margaret was full of the Lord. And we are reminded, and we heard earlier at our previous service, about those words in Psalm 23 about goodness and mercy. And I can surely say that goodness and mercy did indeed follow Mom every day of her life. And she now dwells in the house of the Lord forever. So until we meet again, and I hear the words, hi there. Thank you, Mom, for your amazing godly example to us all and for teaching me so much.
Thank you, Ruth.
How can I capture in a few words the presence of my mom throughout my life? Well, the truth is that I can't. I can't tell you all she means to me. But I know that nothing exists independently. And I know that my mom lives on in me. She shaped me. She loved me. And she was my friend. So, being strong like she was. My dear mom was a strong, hard-working and big-hearted woman. She was a loving wife and a mother, and she was so devoted to her grandchildren and great-grandchildren. They gave her so much joy. My mom touched many lives, and I owe so much to her. She was a distinctive Tibbenham, who throughout her life thought the world of her sisters, Sybil and Josie. She was proud to have been their big sister, and right to the end, loved to keep us all up to date with stories of Sarah, Tim, Matthew, and their families. As we all know, they were a formidable and hilarious threesome. My mum was fiercely proud of her grammar school education and completing her school certificate, something she never let us forget. In some ways, she felt, and rightly felt, that her academic potential had not been realised. But she went on to achieve some incredible things later in her life, including when she trained and became a night school teacher while holding down a full-time job. As John said, John and I both owe a great debt of gratitude to our mum. She valued education and taught us both to read before we started school. I have fond memories of our Thursday night walks as children to the local library in Handsworth Wood, where we would choose books to read. After a few years, we'd read all the books there. So then it was every week on the bus to the big main library on Soho Road in Handsworth so that we could continue our passion for reading. Our mum wanted us to have interests and hobbies and inspired us to be adventurous. So for John, it was cubs and cricket, cars and drums. For me, it was ballet, girl guides, drama and guitar. She wanted us both to play the piano, so she took us, I'd probably say kicking and screaming, on the bus into Birmingham every Saturday morning so that we could have piano lessons in a little music shop next to the Birmingham Rep. Mum worked hard to ensure we reaped the benefits of a broad education. Of course, as children, we failed to appreciate all that she did. But fortunately, Mum persevered, convinced of the upside of failure. And the successful careers that John and I have enjoyed are due to Mum's continued persistence and belief in our early lives. She was a warrior in the best sense of the word. Her thirst for knowledge never left her. How she loved to read her Daily Guardian. Her newspaper gave her great pleasure and insight. She loved to be well informed and to engage in wide-ranging conversations and debates. She always had opinions and a lot to say. She was a remarkable woman who rose above the expectations of her gender and social norms, and I'm really proud of who she was and her intellectual hunger. If you knew our mom, you know that she never sat still for long. She was always active and on her feet. She cycled as a teenager and loved to swim all her life, especially in the little river behind Hoot House with Dad in Abergynolwyn. She walked until she was in her 80s and enjoyed pottering in her garden. I'll always remember her beautiful rose garden at Somerset Road, and the scent of roses always take me back there. As John has said, and others will confirm, my mum loved to help other people. If anyone needed a hand, a favour or a lift, she'd be there. She found it hard to accept help in return and was selfless in the way she supported others. Her greatest act of care and devotion was to look after my nan when she'd had a stroke. She was paralysed and never spoke a word again. She couldn't write, so communication was impossible. But Mum cared for her for 15 years, helping her to wash, bathe and dress every morning, cooking every meal for her and helping her to knit again. She helped my nan to live a meaningful and happy life despite her life-changing stroke. How my mum loved her grandchildren. She was fiercely proud of each of them, and it was a source of great joy to her that she and Dad were able to help them buy their own homes. She was so delighted when Holly and George finally got the keys to their flat in July, the last of the grandchildren to get on the property ladder. She was endlessly positive about her grandchildren. Any problem they faced was always seen in the most positive light, and she loved to know every detail of their lives, their loves and their careers. One of her last diary entries noted this. Ruth rang, Tom and Jenna together. She loved to know and chat about the unfolding lives of her grandchildren. Chats I will miss. Yes, there is much I'll miss because Mum gave so much to me and to us all. I'm proud of my mum. She remains in our thoughts and memories as an extraordinary character. But for the most part, she remains hidden in us. In John, her husband, our dad. In her children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren. I love you, Mum.
Thank you, Ruth. We're now going to hear from Andrew and Carissa.
Yeah, just building on top of everything everyone has said, Nan was such an amazing woman. She was... Me? Oh. Yeah, she was such an amazing woman of many talents, and she loved her grandchildren so much. It was so evident. We used to love spending time with her, and we were fortunate to spend time with her before they moved to Wales. Jim and I, as the eldest, on Fridays we used to go to Somerset Road, and then when they moved to Wales we used to regularly go down and see them and spend time. And yeah, she took us up mountains when she was 80. She would, yeah, we would go and swim in the river, like Smee mentioned, and we would just spend these amazing weeks. And I was thinking about it recently, and of all the things we did, like going on the trains, or the favourite times were probably around the table with Nan and Grandad, just chatting, because we would have these meal times, and Nan would cook some amazing food, and we would chat about what we were doing, and they were so interested in us, and Nan was so interested in, like Auntie Ruth said, she loved her Guardian. In the morning at breakfast, she'd polish off the Guardian cryptic crossword in half an hour while everyone was having their breakfast with these ridiculous clues, and their the lunchtime ritual of watching a game show, and Nan would know all the answers. She was her mind was just amazing, and her love for Grandad, their relationship as an example. And she was long-suffering with Grandad. She put up with him for so many years, scouring car boots and eBay, buying gadgets and computers and iPads. But she was a beneficiary of this, as she had these word games. She was an avid gamer. There are many people know that. She'd go on Grandad's computer and play these word games. And just always wanted to learn and to expand what she was doing. She was an adventurer. Her and Grandad travelled, and they used to come back with gifts and tales of where they'd been around the world. And yeah, they were just an amazing couple together, and Nan was such an amazing person who just meant so much to all of that. Yeah, and just teaching us the importance of family, the importance of being interested in each other, supporting each other, being selfless, being someone who was constantly there whenever she was, even if she was visiting you, she'd be, what can I do, what can I help with? It's just that example, and yeah, just that legacy she leaves for us as her Nan, that we'll always remember, of someone who would loved us so much and was so invested in our lives, and yeah, just love spending time with us. It's something we're very, very grateful for. And yeah, that's just some thoughts about Nan.
I spent a while thinking about what I wanted to say about Nanny, who she was, and our memories together when thinking about today. And I feel very fortunate, as we've heard, to have shared so many fond and happy times with Nanny. When I think of who she was to me, I saw her as a strong, fiercely intelligent, independent woman who was confident in herself, which, as a girl growing up, seeing her live her life the way she did was amazing. I thought of Nanny as someone who was genuinely happy in her own skin, and that was beautiful and inspiring. She taught me about body positivity and confidence just by living her life and being herself. Watching her swimming in Wales, in the sea, wearing whatever she wanted to do, being her 100% herself all of the time, was awe-inspiring. Nanny, as we've heard, was one of those people who was always aware of other people's needs. She was very, very kind. I remember being on holiday with one of my friends, Mel, once. We were very young, and we saw somebody with additional needs, and she quickly and carefully explained to us what they were going through, and she was so considerate and compassionate. And it's hard to know how to handle situations sometimes with curious children, but Nanny saw that and helped us understand in such a compassionate, sensitive and kind way. She was the type of person that if she knew what you liked, then she always had it in. Me and Rach behind, we used to go on holiday. She came on holiday to Wales with us for over 10 years, and we just really liked to eat melon. So she used to always have countless melons in the house as soon as we'd go there, and she used to cut it in a certain way. She'd slice it, then cut it, and slice it again, and give us a fork so that we wouldn't get sticky hands. And it's such a random little memory, but I always used to get really excited about it and look forward to it, because she just knew what we wanted and just had it there. And I was a very fussy eater as a child, and I didn't really like any food, but I used to really love Nanny's garlic bread. It used to be garlic from her own garden. She used to cut the garlic up, and it was incredibly strong garlic bread. But I remember one year I just ate. She just made me, I don't know why, but she made me so many sticks of this garlic bread. And that's all I ate for about a day. And then I was violently sick. But it was worth it, especially for the effort made by Nanny. Holidays with you and Nanny were incredible. They welcomed my friends with two older brothers who just did their own thing. I was always allowed to bring a friend, which was usually Rach behind me. They adopted my friends as adopted granddaughters, and so much so that Rach even said that she felt like she'd lost her own nan. Together, you and Nanny were fun, happy, full of joy and love. And I'll leave you with something that Nanny said to me almost every single time that I saw her. We don't need these men, Chris. Us girls have to stick together. And we definitely did.
Thank you. And now Holly is going to bring our poem.
So I did try and find a poem that was already written to read, but just couldn't quite find the right one. And I found that so many poems about grandmothers were just much too much about cooking. So I have written one, which I will read in 1 second, but I just wanted to take a small moment to acknowledge Josie and Sybil. And I loved my nan so much, and I have so many brilliant memories with her. But one of the greatest gifts that she gave me were these two brilliant great aunties who loved her so much. I'm so glad that Josie's with us today, and we're all thinking of Sib, who is up in Scotland. And I just know how much she adored you both, and how much she loved calling you up and gossiping about all the grandchildren. And I'm just so grateful to have you both in my life and in my heart. But on to Nan. So this is a poem that I've written, and it's called Dog Off Falls. Somewhere a little girl stares at a waterfall while a boy scrambles rocks nearby. She is asking the woman that brought them here, hands bedecked in silver rings and feet in worn walking boots, what happens to the water? Where does it go and why? Exact answer long forgotten, but the water goes back into everything, into cold Welsh crabbing sea and the rain, into rivulets and the morning dew, covering a garden hand brought to bloom, into the bottle feeding birds at the kitchen window. There, water goes and returns to fall again. And now I think of all the returnings of you. Guardian pages read religiously, now links click shared in passion by grandkids. Library trips every Thursday turned Sully Hall Library Saturdays for me made a writer. Carissa and Rachel extravagantly costumed for a parade, and now Annie in princess attire, twins soon too. Jim and Andy walking routes from You Learned. In Mom's Sudoku, I hear the countdown clock. Tom in Castles Now, begun with Walks to Castley Bear. And in the stories often told of wrong turns mistaken, I see my catty-brained left turn no right self. But if I got from you my misplacing, we daughters and granddaughters and great have to our will and right to thought unshaken. Somewhere, Welsh plays on the radio of an English woman. A gossiping sister rings to be told of golden grandchildren. Crabs are caught and released, and the waters of Dog Off still fall. And now we think of you, sister and wife, and a mother and grandmother and great, a waterfall of woman returning in us all. Thank you.
Thank you, Holly. We're now going to move to our next hymn, There Is a Redeemer. Would you please stand? please be seated.
Brothers and sisters, I want you to know the truth about those who have died, so that you will not be sad, as are those who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will take back with Jesus those who have died believing in him. What we are teaching you now is the Lord's teaching. We who live, we who are alive on the day the Lord comes, will not go ahead of those who have died. There will be a shout of command, the archangel's voice, the sound of God's trumpet, and the Lord himself will come down from heaven. Those who have died believing in Christ will rise to be life first. Then we who are living at that time will be gathered up along with them in the clouds to meet with the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. So then, encourage one another with these words. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, John. Paul wrote his letter to the church in Thessalonica in around 51 AD. We think it's his first recorded letter as found in Scripture, so it's less than 20 years after the resurrection of Jesus. Paul planted a church in Thessalonica on his second missionary journey around 50 AD, so it's a very, very young congregation. And Christians back then believed that Jesus would come back in their lifetime. Nothing unusual about that, is there? Christians in every generation have believed that, not least ours today. Presumably, from the reading of the letter, some of these new converts in Thessalonica had died. This has unsettled the church. Paul had been made aware of it, and so he writes to encourage them and correct their understanding. And as we heard, he says, "Our friends, we want you to know the truth about those who have died, so that you will not be sad, as are those who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will take back with Jesus those who have died believing in him." And now, of course, we're thinking about Margaret, and I presume that's one of the reasons she chose that passage. And as I said, it seems that Christians in Thessalonica were concerned that dead Christians would miss out on the subsequent blessings associated with the return of Jesus. Paul says, don't be sad. You don't need to be. Paul, in our reading, then talks about the Lord coming down from heaven. And he says, those Christians who have died and those who are still alive will meet. A glorious picture of believers from every generation throughout history coming together to meet the Lord. Of course, today we grieve our loss, for Margaret was a wonderful woman, as we have heard in all the tributes. She is no longer present. We miss her, her voice, her throwaway comments, her touch. But I don't believe we need to grieve for Margaret, for she is even now, as we've heard, with the Lord Jesus, free from any aches or ailments, because Margaret put her faith in the Lord Jesus. In him she believed. In him she was devoted. She lived for his glory. In the Gospel of John, Jesus says this: "For God loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not die, but have eternal life." Well, Margaret believed in him. She is not dead. She is eternal. She has eternal life. And that is available to every single person who ever lived. When Jesus talks about God loving the world, he's talking about everything in it. Every man, every woman, boy and girl. It includes every one of us here today. If you've never considered Jesus, then I would really encourage you to do so. He loves you. He died for you. He wants to be with you for all eternity. Today, we miss Margaret, but only for a time. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, one day we will meet again, never to be parted. Thanks be to God. Amen. So we turn to prayer. Father in heaven, we give you thanks for your servant Margaret. We praise you as we recollect her life and cherish her memory. We bless you that in bearing your image, she has brought light to our lives. For we have seen in her friendship reflections of your compassion, in her integrity demonstrations of your goodness, in her faithfulness glimpses of your eternal love. Grant to each of us, beloved and bereft, the grace to follow her good example, so that with her we may come to your everlasting kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who died and rose again, and opened the gate of glory, to whom be praise for all eternity. Amen. We give you thanks and praise, Almighty Father, that you sent your Son to die and raised him from the dead for the salvation of all. We thank you for Margaret, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, and now through faith rejoices with the saints in glory. We thank you for our sister who shared the bread of life, a foretaste of the eternal banquet of heaven. We thank you for our deceased relatives and friends who have helped us in the faith and now find rest from their labours. We thank you that the family and friends of our sister Margaret may be consoled in their grief by the Lord. We pray for all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom. And so let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We come to our final hymn, In Christ Alone. Please stand. Thank you. please be seated. We come to the commendation and the blessing. Almighty God, in your great love, you crafted us by your hand and breathed life into us by your spirit. Although we became a rebellious people, you did not abandon us to sin. In your tender mercy, you sent your Son to restore us in your image. In obedience to your will, he gave up his life for us, bearing in his body our sins on the cross. By your mighty power, you raised him from the grave and exalted him to the throne of glory. Rejoicing in his victory and trusting in your promise to make alive all who turn to Christ, we commend Margaret to your mercy, and we join with all your faithful people and the whole company of heaven in the one unending song of praise. Glory and wisdom and honour be to our God for ever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, make you perfect in every good work to do his will. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Did you give a...
Yeah, because I was made redundant.
yet, I mean.